doesn't do any good, does it? And there's nothing anyone can do about it. But then I realized that he never complained in his whole life, not just when he was, you know, fighting the fight. And let me see here where I am. It was just the opposite with him. He always put a joke to it. Right at the end, when he could barely talk, he still had his sense of humor. Like Kara and I were telling him right at the end, how much we loved him, how much we loved him. And he said, enough, girls, that's enough. I think we were kind of bugging him. But anyway, I really hope that he can live through you grandkids and your kids, and you will all do that for him and make that be a part of who you are, okay? And I hope, I don't want to talk long, so I want a lot of other people here, or not a lot, but some have wonderful things to say. So I'm going to wrap it up. But remember him and smile at everyone, be kind to everyone, and just don't ever complain. That's a hard one to do. I've been trying to do it myself, and I'm not getting very far.
You promised, Mom, always positive going forward.
This is true. Oh, I forgot to say one thing. My children have married the best children I can imagine, the best people I can imagine. And I am so blessed to have Taylor Pillsbury, Jill's husband, and my wonderful, wonderful daughter-in-law, Sam. She is another daughter to me. She's more than a daughter-in-law. And Rob with Kara. I'm very, very blessed. I couldn't have nicer family people and greater kids. And also, I'd like to introduce to you quickly, Taryn, Jack's girlfriend from 8 years. 8 years, we don't know when something's gonna happen. And stand up, Taryn, stand up. And Cooper. Cooper is Audrey's. And stand up and say hello, because they are becoming a part of our family. And if I forgot anybody, I'm really sorry.
All right, so before we dive into a bunch of really great stories, I can't wait to hear it. So much content to work with Lou. Where does it start and end? Whoever wants to come up and speak later, you're more than welcome. But I just want to recognize my little sister, Kara, who did such an amazing job in planning all of today's festivities with my mom. But Kara, you really did an unbelievable job, did all the heavy lifting with Mom, and Jill and I didn't do much of anything. So anyway, really great job done. So with that, I would like to turn it over to Jack Pillsbury. Come on up.
Hello, everyone. For those that don't know, my name is Jack Pillsbury, and Lou, or Pop-Up, was my grandpa. I think when someone passes, people reach out, you know, think of all the positive memories that you have of that person. Luckily for me, growing up in Laguna, I had tons of those to look back on with Pop-Up, as I'm sure many of you all do as well. I think, you know, there always be the Little League games that he would come coach. He never missed one. Batting practice, messing around at the driving range, golfing, he would give me crap that Charlie was kicking my butt, and working on my swing. Horse in the driveway, dinners down at Balboa on the spoiling nights where I'd come over and spend the night. What else? There was the baseball cards we would go through that are now in my office and are a nice little daily reminder of Pop-Up and all the great times we had. The great times in McCall, where just last summer, Taryn and I were out there with two other couples, and we're sitting on the dock with Diddy and Pop-Up, and the guys go in to go refill the cooler or something back in the condo, And sure enough, we come back out and Pop-Pop's serenading the three ladies and Diddy on the dock. And just, you can hear it from the condo. And they always ask about Pop-Pop. And he was definitely a huge presence that you felt. There was the one time driving to Palm Springs where he had just joined the volunteer police department. And we were driving up there. I think my dad was in the car. And this radio ad comes on, advertising for volunteer members to come join the force. And in the tagline, this guy in a super deep voice is saying, "We need more, you know, individuals to help join. Just remember, part-time deputy, full-time hero." And so we get out of the car, and I couldn't wait. I think I was a freshman in high school or something. I run to Pop-Up, Pop-Up. Part-time deputy, full-time hero. And then from then on, he loved to tell people that that was his tagline. Pretty good. So thankfully, I have some amazing literal memories to draw on that I'll always have with me. But it's how Pop-Pop approached life that's what I hope to carry with me most. I think, you know, we heard it from the priest today, that he was truly full of life. And I think people use that term to describe others a lot, that they want to be full of life. I'm not quite sure anyone embodied that as well as Pop-Pop did. He made a conceited effort to make others smile and brighten a stranger's day. That was evident when I'd come home for visits, and the gate guard would always show genuine and serious concern about how Pop-Pop was doing. They genuinely cared because Pop-Pop genuinely cared about them. Not someone that he necessarily had to be overly friendly with, but felt he needed to because that's how people should be treated. If there's one thing myself and others here should try to emulate from Pop-Pop, it's to make a conscious effort to bring joy to a stranger's life and have a mentality to brighten someone else's day. So when a stranger's having a rough day, think of what Pop-Pop would do. When I was walking into church today, I had the realization it was the first family gathering where we were missing Pop-Pop. Missing the smile and the commentary of looking sharp, Cooper, Jackie, you didn't shave. While he might not be here physically, we should know he's smiling down, singing, laughing, and dancing. For Dax, Jake, Ava, Archie, Audrey, and Charlie, just remember, for graduations, weddings, kids, other life events, Pop-Pop will always be down, well, smiling down and running the party from above. Odds, you want to come up?
Oh man, my Pop-Pop was a lot of things. He was kind, he saw the best in people, he made people laugh, he built friendships with ease, and he radiated warmth. A jokester, a golfer, an athlete, a volunteer, a big fan of phone calls, a singer, and above all else, an amazing grandfather. Pop-Pop was always there. Soccer games across the country in below zero conditions. You bet he was in the stands, giant parka, yelling, "Let's go, Odds!" Christmas Eve and Thanksgiving dinners, I usually managed to rig the table settings just to make sure we ended up next to one another. Tennis, ping pong, pickleball games, I don't think I ever quite beat him. Birthdays, the voicemails of him singing always made my day. In fact, his consistent voicemails were a constant in my life. Usually they were just simple messages, saying to call him back, to answer my damn phone every once in a while. But they always said, "I love you, sweetie. When are you coming back down here?" No matter where I was, be it Laguna, New York, London, or Seattle, I always knew he was a call away. Not a text, something he prided himself in never coming around to, but a call. And there was so much comfort in knowing that. The thing is, though, he wasn't just always there. As many people have said today, he made spaces and places better. He made things more joyful, and he was someone you simply just wanted to be next to. Whether it was greeting the waiters in Ironwood with their name and a giant hug and a string of questions about their family, their kids, their plans for college, whatever it was. Or singing to toll booth workers in upstate New York, no matter the hour, he would just start bursting out in song at the toll booth workers in the middle of the night coming up to visit. Heck, watching Fox News with him was even bearable, and that is saying something. His approach to interacting with others, though, it always inspired me. He consistently greeted friends and strangers with enthusiasm. He never thought he was above anyone or anything, and he effortlessly made people feel comfortable and at ease. When things started to take a turn with his health, I was with him in the hospital one afternoon. He was exhausted, and every single time that he would begin to doze off, his phone would ring. I swear it rang about 75 times in the 5 hours I was there. And while it didn't surprise me how many friends, old and new, he had calling, it did amaze me that every single time he answered with the same upbeat tone, energetic demeanor, and enthusiasm. He would crack a joke, greet them by their nickname, and reflect on memories and give them all the time in the world until they were done talking. He'd then fall back asleep, only for a minute, before the next caller. That was him, though. He cared so much about his people, and how grateful we are all here today to have been some of his people and to have had some of his love. My pop-up has always been there, making places and spaces better. And while I wish more than anything I could greet him with another kiss on the cheek and hear him call me sweetie, I find comfort in knowing that his spirit is surrounding us, filling us up with that bit of light that we all need in some moments that we're down. So with that, I would love if everyone could raise a glass and cheers to my pop-up and to the light that he brought into all of our lives. He was truly one of a kind.
Thank you, Audrey. Charlie Pills seems to have lost his voice. Oh, here we go. Found it. Come on up, Char. You got this.
Charlie Pillsbury, I didn't prepare anything quite like my older siblings did, but I was lucky enough 2 years ago to go do a weekend in Ironwood with Diddy and Pop-Pop, and golf was something we bonded over a lot. That and baseball were two big parts of his life, and I got to share those with him kind of last couple years. And biggest takeaway is anytime I either step foot on a golf course or have a ball in my hand playing catch with friends, he's always going to be there in my heart. He's a good man. He's going to stick with all of us. He's made an impact on a lot of people's lives, and I hope to do, we all should aspire to do something similar to that. Won't be to the same degree because I don't think it's matchable, but we can all try somewhere. All right, guys.
At this point, I'd like to welcome Dr. Jim Padova up to say a few words. Here he is.
Hey, we're short.
Can I help you up there?
Only 7 foot.
We're get you louder.
We were from different parts of Italy. I'm from the short section. Anyway, Christy asked me to share a few thoughts with her, and I have about probably a 25-minute talk here. But Christy did ask me to share some thoughts about and my memories of Lou with you guys today. And Marilyn and I met Lou and Christy when they joined our fantasy couples football group about 35 years ago, I guess. And at that first meeting, I spoke to Lou at the couple's dinner party. And when I introduced myself as, gave him my name, Jim Padova, he immediately recognized the name Padova because he had visited his family's city of origin in a small Italian town called Torcella Polegna, which is in eastern Italy, sitting on top of a mountain, so to speak, overlooking the Adriatic. And he told me that during that visit, he remembers that when he was touring the small cemetery that was located at the end of the main street in Torcella Polegna, next to his family's D'Ambrosio gravesite was the Di Padova family gravesite. And of course, I explained to him that our family's real name is Di Padova, that my father had dropped the Di Padova, the D from the Padova, some years before. And of course, his father was angry at him for doing that. But anyway, we had that conversation, and we immediately connected. And we remained paisans, which basically sort of means close friends and buddies, even family, thereafter. In fact, I always wondered whether we might have shared similar genes, because our families probably lived in close proximity in such a small, isolated town in Italy. You know, you never know. I realized that we both had married and loved beautiful, demure, passive women who beckoned to our every desire and wishes. So, you know, that made me feel, well, maybe there is a genetic connection here. I also thought, well, we were both pretty good looking. For example, I was short and had a big bulbous nose and was balding, and Lou was tall, extremely handsome, with curly, beautiful hair. Lou had a wonderful voice, and I thought, geez. I did have a singing experience. I was a member of 100 all-boy choir in our college glee club. I was in the bass section, so you can't hear him, right? No. But we had similarities there, too. Again, this genetic connection from mine. We were both good-looking. Lou is tall, extremely handsome, with curly hair, and as I said, I was short and balding. Lou's personality was such that mostly everybody wanted to associate with him. It was, you know, he was fun to be around. All the guys knew that. They enjoyed his company. Those of you that knew him probably roared with laughter at his quick wit and never-ending joke-telling. I still can see Christy rolling her eyes when he started out with another joke that she had heard a million times. Especially the Lone Ranger and the stupid horse trigger jokes, or the Italian jokes, what are you trying to kill mama, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Lou is personable, athletic, and intelligent. He was always interested in how our family was doing, and when we were at our home in Palm Desert, after golf, he would drive by our house in his golf cart and shout up to Marilyn, "Hey, Marilyn, is the little guinea home?" A very personable compliment to me, being little and Italian. Sort of an Italian slang, but it's positive. Although, as you can see, for many years, Christy, Lou, Marilyn, and I shared so many enjoyable times together, since I am an oncologist, I also spoke frequently to Lou and Christy about his medical problems with his cancer diagnosis. It became clear that his medical problems were continuing to progress in spite of the best standard of cancer care that he was receiving. Christy and Lou, though, confronted the reality together and explored, with the help from Lou's primary treating cancer specialist, all possible new treatments that could possibly control his disease. In spite of receiving the newest breakthrough forms of radiation therapy, unfortunately, his condition worsened, causing increasing pain and disability, such that Lou required total assistance with all his daily activities. During those last 4 or 5 months, I visited Lou and Christy frequently at their home in Newport Beach. I marveled how Christy was personally attentive to his basic needs 24 hours a day at home. During those last months, because only minimal movement was so painful for Lou, Christy engaged additional professional aides to help care for him. Joy. 2 to 3 months. Before he died, when no one was there except he and I, he asked me how long he would live. you know, I read this in front of Marilyn and a couple of times before I could stop feeling emotional. But anyway, I shared with him my professional opinion. He quietly thanked me, closed his eyes. Although I had answered that question hundreds of times before as a cancer specialist, I left his room. Went outside and cried. God damn you, Lou. Anyway, as I now reflect on these multiple last months of Lou's life, which were so difficult for my friend because of his progressing cancer, I still see the peaceful look on his face when he slept. And you know what Father said at Mass today? I think that might have correlated with the time when Father said he accepted Jesus. Remember that comment? When Father said that he talked quietly to Lou and he accepted Jesus. I wonder whether the timing of that was what I was now seeing in those last 2 months of his life. After all, he was at home in familiar surroundings with the love of his life, Christy, who was there close to him 24 hours a day. She would have and did move heaven and earth to keep him close to her because he was her hero and the love of her life. God bless you and thank you, Christy, for showing what true love should look like. Jim. Oh. And Louis did want to say something. My gift to you.
That was beautiful. Thank you, Jim. Paisans. Okay, next up, Lou's partner in crime, Mr. Clayton Mays, the ex-chief of police of Downey and captain with the LAPD. Would you come on up, Clayton?
Thank you. I'm going to make this short. Part-time deputy, full-time hero. That was best. I'm honored to say a few words about my good friend Lou D'Ambrosia. For over 5 years, Lou trained and served as a reserve officer with the Indio Police Department. More specifically, Lou was assigned as an aviation observer, that was one of his jobs, in the Indio PD Air Support where after I'd retired as a chief, I went back as a commander of the air support as a reserve officer. And Lou was a very important part of that organization. Lou acquired his complete required his extensive law enforcement training at College of the Desert Public Safety Academy, where I was also the director. He did this while I was there, but I knew him before he got there. And after completing his training, he applied to be a reserve officer with the NDO Police Department. I encouraged him to do this. He had an extensive background. They investigated him. I mean, he may not have known all the stuff that you guys were talking about today, but he was investigated. He did a polygraph examination, and then he did a complete medical examination. And this is the process that you go through to become either a full-time police officer or a reserve officer. And the more I got to thinking about it, I was thinking, can you imagine Lou D'Ambrosio taking that polygraph examination with all the stuff that he was involved in, including golf on the golf course? Anyhow, all I'm authorized to tell you today is that he did pass that examination. You know, he was an absolute expert marksman. He loved firearms, and he was an expert with firearms. He was a strong advocate of firearm safety, and he set an example for our entire division. Part of Lou's duties included him serving as this aviator or aviation observer during the annual Coachella festivals that we have out there every year now. And when they really started those, Lou started with the police department and helping us with that. He assisted the officers on the ground with both crime and traffic control information from a fixed-wing aircraft. You know, to get to the point, more importantly, how about Lou? We had it before. What was it? Part-time deputy, he's part-time officer, full-time hero. Lou served with honor. He was a team player. He was a team builder. He was a leader in that group. He contributed much to the success of the unit. And in addition to that, he served the public well. On December the 31st, 2011, both Lou and myself decided that it was time for us to retire. And so we retired from that on the same day as reserve officers. That concluded 38 years of me involved in law enforcement. And with Lou, he concluded over 5 years being a reserve officer there. It contributed greatly. And Lou is going to be missed. There's no doubt about that. I appreciate you, Christy, giving me the opportunity to tell you something about his service to the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Clayton. Next up, guys, we're gonna play a video from Lou's good pal from his Wesleyan college days, Phil Rockwell, who was not able to make it here in person, but made a beautiful video that we're gonna show shortly, and he's back in Connecticut right now.
My name is Phil Rockwell, and I live in Canton, Connecticut. I am privileged to speak today about Lou D'Ambrosio, and I'm very sorry I cannot be with you in person. First, deepest sympathies to Christy and to her and Lou's family and countless friends. Lou's passing is a huge loss that continues to be difficult for us all to believe. Lou and I met in 1961 at Wesleyan. Lou was a sophomore when I arrived in Middletown as a freshman. We initially became friends as baseball teammates and remained close friends for the next 60 years. What a blessing that has been for me. Lou was a standout second baseman with amazing hands and also a stellar soccer player with amazing feet. Things I'm told he has passed on to his grandson. And Lou remained an outstanding athlete throughout his life. On the ball field, Lou had a special relationship with our coach, Norm Daniels, known to everyone as Danny. Danny was a stickler for tradition and rules, things Lou didn't always follow to the letter. Lou was much more of a free spirit. One spring afternoon in the late innings of a very important game, Lou was on third base with a left-handed pitcher on the mound. Good friend Steve Humphrey was coaching third, and Lou whispered to him that he was going to steal home because the pitcher never looked back but once to third to check the runner. Steve said, "You better not try because Danny will kill you." Well, Lou took off on the next pitch and slid in just before the catcher could apply the tag. Danny didn't know what to think or say, so he just ran out to home plate and said, "Lou, you knew you had it all the way, didn't you, Lou? You knew you had it all the way." In addition to taking liberties on the base pass, Lou had the knack of somehow finding places to stay at the homes of folks he didn't actually know that well. This led us to give him the well-earned nickname, America's Guest. However, in 1997, he was one very welcome guest at our home in Connecticut when he came for Cindy's and my wedding. Not only did he charm everyone he met, he was of enormous help in pulling the wedding off, as it was a quote-unquote do-it-yourself affair held at our home. He was probably the closest thing we had to a wedding planner. Cindy and I will always be grateful to him for his assistance. One of Lou's most wonderful attributes was the way he treated everyone, a waiter at a restaurant or a Wall Street billionaire, exactly the same. He was bright, upbeat, kind, positive, self-effacing, and witty. And as you can tell by the video of his singing the national anthem at the Angels game, he had a great measure of self-confidence and was never afraid to perform anytime, anywhere. In fact, a major highlight of our trips to the Caribbean island of Barbuda in the 80s were his renditions of many Sinatra songs, notably New York, New York. As we always said, Lou sang Sinatra better than Sinatra. We partied in the Caribbean, skied in Switzerland, played baseball in Connecticut and Florida in our 20s, and then again in Florida in our 50s. Countless memories that will always be with me. And one final message. Christy well remembers whenever Lou and I got together, we played various sports to who would possess the D'Ambrosio Rockwell World Decathlon Trophy. An old beaten up Michelob beer can with a little plaque that reads, "Awarded in recognition of excellence in sports competition and enduring friendship." Well, the final total of 398 events over many years stands at 199-199. You know what? I'll take a tie with you anytime, Lou. And thank you for being such a wonderful friend.
Beautiful. Thank you, Phil. Beautiful. So much ado about the Angels national anthem. How did that come about, everyone says? Well, I told my cousin Scott, I said, well, Lou just asked for the order, not just once or twice, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times, eventually got the order. So here to tell us a little bit more about that backstory is Mr. John Carpino, the president of the Angels.
I really didn't want to be at Lou's memorial telling this story, but he was very special to me. Before I start, I want to tell this one story because it kind of summarizes who Lou was and who Christy was. And I always remember this. So we were talking, and coincidentally, we were going to be in Idaho at the same time. And I'm going, "Where are you going to be?" And he goes, I'm going to be in McCall. I go, "I'm going to be in McCall." "Great. I'll meet you at the Shore Lodge." We'll meet at the Shore Lodge. So me, Kim, and Christy at the Shore Lodge. It's like 8 o'clock. I come in there, and Lou and Christy are sitting there, and a dozen people around him, laughing, talking, drinking, and everything. I come there and sit and talk to these people for like 15, 20, 30 minutes. We're sitting and talking, and then they get up and leave, and I shake their hands and everything. And I turn to Lou, I go, are those your family? He goes, no, we just met them. But that's who Christy and Lou were, you know. They would meet people, and you think you'd know them for your whole life, and they knew them for 5 minutes. And anyway, so I'll tell the story. This is some people in here have heard the story. So Taylor and I and Jill and my wife Elizabeth are good friends, and we live in the neighborhood. Taylor invites This is about 10 years ago. Taylor invites me to golf. He goes, I'm golfing a Laguna Beach High School tournament. Why don't you golf with me and get a chance to see each other? So I go, great. So we're driving there, and he goes, hey, I'm going to golf with Jack's coach, the baseball coach, and you're going to golf with my father-in-law. I go, oh, great. That's why. He goes, no, you'll have a good time. So I get in a golf cart, and so, I, you know, I'm checking the boxes for Lou. You know how he is. You know, I'm Italian, he's Italian. You know, baseball. So a couple holes go by, and then he starts working. He goes, God, you worked that? Yeah, who's in charge of, like, the national anthem? I go, God, I don't know. You know, I'll have to check who does that kind of stuff. You know, just having fun, because, Lou's grandkids know that Lou and I used to just have the best relationship, just teasing each other, you know, You'd wear this T-shirt of mine around all the time, and Jack would text me. He goes, he's wearing your T-shirt. I go, because it's free, Jack. That's why he's wearing it, you know. So anyway, hole after hole, Lou starts, he goes, no, I'm really good. You really should have me. Second hole of song, third hole of song, fourth hole of song. It's a song after song. It's all Frank Sinatra songs. So he winds up hitting, he sings The Summer Wind, right? And so then I get sentimental because my wife and I, that was our wedding song. So I go, all right, Lou, you can sing the national anthem. And he goes, really? Are you kidding? You know, I go, no, if you just quit singing, I'll let you sing the national anthem. So he goes, you know, a couple holes, when? You know, I go, next week. How's next week sound? And he goes, all right, next week, right? And I go, yeah, next week. You could sing the national anthem. And then Lou, you know, we stretch, who are they playing? I go, we're playing the Yankees next week. And after a couple holes go by, he goes, so wait a minute. You know, like, Taylor, is this guy legit? You know, he's going to let me sing? You know, he goes, and Taylor goes, if John said, Lou, you know, you're going to sing. So he goes, let me get this straight. You know, so we finish golfing, we have a beer and so forth, and teasing each other back and forth, and he goes, all right, you know, you're Italian, I'm Italian, you have to make this promise. I'm going to sing the national anthem at Angel Stadium next week against the Yankees. I go, yes, Lou, I promise. On your kids. Yes, Lou, on my kids. So drive home, and a couple hours later, and my phone rings, and it's Lou, and he goes, you son of a bitch, you know. Well, the Angels were playing at New York that week, and so I go, no, you can come to Angel Stadium and sing by your. Anyway, you know, so I got him on that one, but he got me on a lot more other ones. So it was about a month later he came, and it was just a special night with his family and everything, and he sang the national anthem in the seventh inning stretch, and he was a special person, and myself and everybody in this room will miss him dearly. God bless Lou.
Thanks, John. What an unbelievable moment that was for Lou, and just so grateful. Next up is a really good, close old friend of Lou's from Utah. These two folks have had some wonderful experiences together. Please welcome Mr. Mike Vanderhoof.
Thanks for having us here. I met Lou about 37 years ago. I was in the brokerage business, and he was introduced to me, and so for the last 37 years, we've played a lot of deals and a lot of stocks and had a lot of fun and had winners, losers. Losers never bothered him. He just, there's always another deal. And, you know, a few years after I met him, I invited him up to Utah to go on a deer hunt with us. And it was that weekend that Lou learned what fine wine was. And fine wine comes in a box, doesn't come in a bottle. He brought his own bottle of fine wine, and we did the blind test and said, come on, Lou, tell us which is the fine wine. So he tastes one, tastes the other, And he goes, "This is the fine wine." Well, it was the box wine. So we had a joke going on for years and years about fine wine. So we get near the end of the hunt, and you know, Lou says, "Hey, you think I could shoot your rifle?" And I said, "Yeah, you know how?" And he goes, "Hey, I'm from New Jersey. Of course we know guns." So we pull over and we pick out this bright white rock on the side of the hill, and he gets a scope up and he shoots. And you know, for those of you that have shot rifles, if you don't hold it tight against your shoulder, if you get your eye too close, you get scoped. And it kicks, and it usually, most people, they get scoped above their eye. But Lou, being Italian, his nose got in the way. And in fact, I was looking at this picture, and I think he's still, that's the scope mark on his nose. And so, you know, when I hear these stories about him becoming a deputy, I said, "Are they going to actually give you a gun, Lou?" And he said, "Yeah, Mikey, they're going to give me a gun." And I go, "They don't know you then too well." So anyway, we had a lot of fun years together. I was actually taking him to the airport. He had a Band-Aid across his nose. And we decided to stop by the office before he went to the airport. He wanted to say hi to Gladys, who was the secretary there. And so I had called ahead of time and said, "Hey, Gladys, go buy some Band-Aids and put a Band-Aid on your nose and then pass it out to everybody in the office and have everybody have a Band-Aid." So we walk into the office and he's like, "Hey, Gladys, what happened to your nose?" And she said, "Oh, I was sighting in my gun." And then, of course, it clicked to Lou that he was the brunt of the joke. But Lou and I have had a lot of fun together over the years. He's been a dear friend. And, you know, a lot of the things that were said, I was going to say, but I don't need to repeat it because Lou already has a big enough head. And you know he's looking down, just, you know, gloating up there right now. I also wanted to thank Christy for putting our organization. As you guys know, Lou was very proud of America and very proud of the veterans that served. And I sit on the board of directors of Operation Pay It Forward. We're a 100% volunteer organization. 100% of all the proceeds that we raise go directly to our veterans. And currently, 22 veterans a day commit suicide. It's a sad number. So our organization really focuses on those combat vets, and we get them into the outdoors, whether it's fishing, hunting, horseback riding, golf, whatever it is, to just get them out into nature. And then we ask them to go back home and pay it forward to other veterans in their community. And whatever they want to do, we will pay for it with them, for them to pay it forward. So we currently have 80 ambassadors in 40 states nationwide. And Lou is a great supporter. And I know a lot of donations have already come in to us. And so thank you, everybody. Thank you, Lou. God bless. Thanks.
Thank you, Mike. Thanks for the kind words and for your organization, all that you do there. Lou must have told me about those camping stories a million times. There's Lou the cowboy. I don't know about that. Next we're going to move into some golf stories from the Dew Sweepers, from Otto Ryer. Otto, come on up. So the Dew Sweepers are Lou's crew of buddies here at Newport Beach Country Club. Dew Sweepers, because there's dew early in the morning and they tee off early. So
got it.
Hello.
All right, still works.
Hi. Christy, I love you. You know I love you. And now I love the rest of your family who are here.
Let's just do that. There you go.
Christy, I love you. And I love the family, okay? It was wonderful this morning. I thought it was spectacular. What a tribute to Louis. I'm a member of the Dew Sweepers. The Dew Sweepers are a group of golfers. There's about 22, 24 of us right now. The reason we're the Dew Sweepers, we play early in the morning, okay? That was always a problem for Louis. You know, we'd have to call him in the morning. Louis, you're on the tee. I'm coming. He'd show up. The third group had already teed off. But he was just a little slow when he got on the course. And the reason he was slow, he filled every divot on his way through 18 holes. He poured the sand in. You know Christy the way he was. So we always were on Louis about being slow. Now, a couple of things about Louis. Louis has several names. Louis, Looster in his email, Sweet Lou. If you notice, we have these hats commemorating Lou, okay? But one of the things that Louis and I had, which was personal, he was known as JL, Jersey Lou, okay? And I was known as J.O., Jersey Otto, okay? We were both raised in Jersey. Now, you got to know what a Jersey guy is like. We're a little different, okay? And I got a tape of a guy who explains what Jersey guys are like, okay? And it talks about what Jersey guys can really do. So let me tape. It's a very short tape. Hold on. Hold on.
I think we should have an Italian president from New Jersey running the country from now on. Maybe Mike Marino. Let me think about it. We had an Italian president running the country right now. This war in Afghanistan be over. You wouldn't know how, but it'd be over. And then they'd ask the president, how'd you end the war, Mr. President? He'd be like, don't worry about it. Prices at 32 cents a gallon now, okay?
That's all taken care of.
Think about it. When Bin Laden first made us mad, what did our president do? He sent over the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps. Everybody went to find one guy. An Italian president? No. Two Italians from Jersey be back in 24 hours. They'd have found Bin Laden. They'd have walked right into his cave like it was a hit. Osama? How you doing? Pull up a rock. I want to talk to you about something. I'm already upset with you. I had to get up early. You know how far you live from New Jersey? I tell you what, sit still. Here's what we're going to do for you, Ben. Hey, Vinny, hit him with the bat. Is he dead? Good. War's over. Steal the rugs. Let's get out of here.
That's what Jersey guys are like. No messing around. A lot of people have talked about what's on my list. Louis being a cop, Louis doing golf and things like that. And I want to talk to the young grandchildren. Okay. You understand this about your pop-pop, okay? He's the only person in today's world that still has a flip phone.
Yes. iPhone 20, he called it.
It was an iPhone 1. And Louis loved that. He wasn't going to change. He loved his phone. Okay. Well, He was special to our group. He really was. He was part of a band that we started. We had, the Dew Sweepers had their own band, okay? And Louis was the lead singer of the band. Who else, right? And it was just a fun one night thing we were doing, okay, for one of our Christmas parties. This group went on the road. They were doing clubs around here in Southern California with Louis as the lead singer, okay? He was special. He was special. And for us in the Dew Sweepers, he's somebody we dearly, dearly miss. Thank you.
Thank you, J.O., Jersey Otto. Playing that video about how the Jersey guys do it made me think of, I don't know how many of you guys ended up on Lou's email lists. Oh my God, I hope no one had any work to do, right? There must have been 10 a day that would come through. Anyway, good stuff. Next up is a really good old friend of Lou's that he spent most of his career with, working with Jim Morlis at Celeste Industries. And Jim also made a tape that's gonna show up on the video monitors here. In New York.
Hi, Jim Morlis here. Most of you probably know me or have heard about me. Lou and I worked together at Celeste for over 25 years, and we were very, very close. I first met Lou and Christy in New York when they were returning from the honeymoon, and Celeste hired me shortly after that. Lou and I were email junkies with one another, over 5,000 in the last few years. Some of them were business deals we were in, but most of them were jokes or making fun of one another. His loss has made a big hole in my life and in my heart. Gone are the days when I would kid him about his big Italian nose, and he would tease me about my big Greek belly. Gone are the days where we would identify the problems of the world and offer solutions, some of which were actually pretty good, if I might say so myself. What a special man he was. He was so good at so many things. He would light up the room whenever he entered. Everyone wanted to be his friend. He had a great way with all levels of people. One minute he'd be a regular Joe, and the next he'd be a sophisticated businessman. And he wasn't phony about it. He truly loved people and loved to get to know them. He had a way with women and girls that was simply amazing. First, he was such a handsome guy. Of course, if you like that Italian look. Seriously, he was definitely one good-looking guy. He smiled that beautiful smile, and next thing I know, he'd have the girl's name and would sing her a song. If I saw it once, I saw it a dozen times. Old ladies, plain ladies, fat ones, skinny ones, and they would just beam. He brought so much joy to so many people. And what a voice. We'd go to these conventions, 5,000 people. How many, many times did I see them whooping it up in the aisles as he belted out, New York, New York, on the stage, in his tux, with a huge professional band behind him. Who does this? And then singing at the national anthem at a baseball game with 50,000 fans listening, a cappella, no music, just him and his voice. Again, who does this? Lulu does this. As our friend Rush Limbaugh used to say, talent on loan from God. And what an athlete. He was exceptional at everything. Tennis, he beat all comers at these big conventions. I mean, really good players. He'd take them apart, and I'd make a few bucks on the side betting on them. How about golf? He shot in the 70s most of the time. And he didn't play that much. Pick up basketball, ping pong. He was still playing hardball baseball in his late 30s. I mean, fastball pitching, baseball, spikes, the whole thing. Nobody does that. Talent on loan from God. Now he's gone. He's on a new team now. And I guarantee he He's on God's first string. An amazing man who lived a full life, and I will miss him and never forget him. Rest in peace, brother. Amen.
That was beautiful, Jim. Thank you very much. That concludes our scheduled speakers for the afternoon. If there is anybody else that would like to come up, please do so. Yeah, my Aunt Liz. Liz Heron, come on up.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Liz Heron, better known as Lizzie. I'm Christy's sister and Lou's brother-in-law. And I first met Lulu, when Christy was dating a few other guys on the list. It wasn't just Louis, as everybody, I said, "What? Who are you kidding?" Of course, I'd met both guys, and I was going, "You're going to choose Lou. He's the guy." And so I happened to be the bridesmaid at her wedding, and I meet some of the other Italian relatives, and they're calling him Louis from New Jersey. And I'm going, "Who's this Louis? He's Lulu to me." And so I just wanted to say a few words on his behalf. That Christie's and my other sister, Jennifer, who is deceased but lived in Italy her entire life, would refer sometimes to Louis very teasingly as her big Goomba brother-in-law. And it was always very teasing, and it was just in good humor. But when I really looked up that word, Goomba, it's an anglicized version of an Italian word, which means close friend, associate, patron, advisor, a godfather of sorts. And I think that sums Louis up really nicely. We all knew Lou to be an optimist and a sentimentalist. And one of the things I will miss most is being the recipient of those cheesy emails. Oh man, I think I'm sure many of you who are also lucky enough to be in those threads know exactly what I'm talking about. Day in and day out, the ones with the attachments about the cute puppies snuggling up to a lion, or all the ones about the, a goat, befriending an elephant, or the good old-fashioned days of the 1950s and those Rat Pack days, how things used to be. But in these past few months, I had the great honor and privilege of spending a lot of time with Lou before his passing. He'd made me promise after my sister was deceased, he said, "Lizzie, I want you on my side. When the time comes, you better be here." And so I just have to say that I was so incredibly impressed with the grace with which he embraced his illness and his incredible suffering. I never heard him complain once, and I was with him a lot. Always asking others about their welfare and their lives, concerned with putting others at ease. And I think it was such an incredible gift, as Jim Padova was talking about as well, that he gave to me and his children and his grandchildren, that the way he showed us, the rest of us, how to really die with such grace and style. Making jokes on the day before he died, fielding yet another of 1,000 calls that he received from my daughter, Katie, who phoned and said she'd heard the owls outside her window that morning hooting, and she was going, "Lulu," it said, "Lulu, Lulu," and he corrected her on the day before he died, saying, "No, no, Katie, it's not Lulu, it's Lulu, Lulu." He just had this incredible sense of humor to the end. And towards the very final days, one evening, when poor, exhausted, very given it, diligent Christy, who really rose to the occasion and was there for every single caring moment. But at that time, as she would typically do, was conked out and sacked out on the couch, and Lou and I were surfing the channels, Fox News, 24/7, and Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune, and then I got him hooked on Outlander, which was kind of fun, and there were a couple of racy scenes in there, and he'd call me up, "Lizzie, Lizzie, did you see the latest episode?" It was pretty exciting. But Lou and I were chatting, and he asked me, "Hey, Lizzie, have you ever thought about how old you'd be when you die?" And I kind of went, "Gosh, Lou, no, I've never really thought about that." And he said, "Well, we'll do it right now. How old do you think you'd be when you die?" And I went, "Okay, let me think about this for a sec." And I said, "Well, I don't know, Lou, maybe early 80s, you know, maybe." And I said, "What about you?" And he goes, "Oh, no, 88's my number. I'm living to 88. And I just thought to myself, "Wow, Lou, you go, boy. Good for you." You know, he just had this incredible optimistic attitude to the very end. And I just thought, wow, that his number of 88, and just thinking that he was going to do that, and just being the consummate athlete that he was, and a good sport, that his motto always, you know, you play the game till the last play. The game isn't over until the game's over. And that was for Lou, the day he died. He lived so fully to the last moment that he took his last breath. So in closing, I just want to say, during the early days of COVID, Kristen and Lou very generously opened their doors to me in Palm Desert, and I spent 2 weeks quarantining with them. And besides his jokes, sense of humor, singing to anyone who would lend him an ear, playing golf, picking oranges and lemons from everybody's trees, and you know, just spending that time with him, that we all knew that Lulu's favorite was talking politics. And so the news channels were being on always, 24/7, on every TV, in every room in the house. And our family has been known to have some pretty spirited political conversations over the years between the more liberal side of the family and the conservative. So Lou got a big old kick out of it one of our last evenings together when I told him, "Louie, I promise you, I will watch Fox News once a week just for you, bud." So that's my parting gift to you, Lulu. I wanted you to go out thinking that there was hope yet for your little sister-in-law and for us liberals. So off you go, you big Goomba. I love you, bud.
Anybody else? Words for Lou. Real quick, Taylor's not speaking, but Lou, when my sister and Jill got married, we went to Aspen on a bachelor party. And these were all Phi-Delts from the University of Colorado. They definitely knew how to party and have fun, right? They kind of majored in that. There were probably 20 guys, 25 years old, right? At the end, there was a King Fun Award trophy that was given out, crushed up beer cans, you know, that type of thing. And of course, out of everybody, 20 people there, who gets the King Fun Award but Lou, right? So he outfunded about 20 25-year-olds for the weekend. So anyway, is Doug Muncy here? Doug, you want to come on up and take us out with a prayer here? Okay. Lou also was he collected hats, never threw one away his entire life. And come on up, Doug. And so my mother has brought all of his hats out there on the table. And everybody is encouraged, and we beg of you to take a hat, your favorite hat of Lou's, and the centerpieces. So use everything, like Lou said. We recycle. We've paid for them. Take them.
I have my glasses. I have notes. And I'm going to throw them both away because everything I had on there has been said, and said so nicely by everybody. And the service this morning was just great. And before I close this out, God bless you, and your family, and God can see you through this. So just one more thing. You had mentioned about what you remember about somebody. And I've just got to say, if the one thing that just really impressed me about Lou was whoever he met, wherever he met him, he was so sincere in meeting them, getting to know them, encourage them. And you could go to every employee in this club. They all love Lou. And Lou knew them all by name. And he was a blessing to everybody. So anyway, Christy wanted me to close out, so if you all bow. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful today that we can gather here and reminisce and honor our friend Sweet Lou. We just thank you, Lord, that we can not just celebrate the past, we can celebrate the past, present, and future. And today we've just had fun in rejoicing and in talking about our dear friend. And now, present Lord, we just thank you for welcoming Lou into your arms, giving him a new body with no pain. And Lord, we just know that you must have had a smile on your face when he got there and he serenaded you. And Lord, in the future, for all those that have accepted your salvation through the sacrifice of your son, we will all spend forever with Lou. So thank you that we can celebrate his past, present, and future. In Jesus' name, amen.
Poem that I found four or five copies of that on his desk, a laminated one. So that meant something to him that I feel is what he chose, not me or anyone else, but I feel like that was what he chose. And I think the message is a very powerful one. So I hope you all know that that is, was his feeling. So thank you all for being here.
We have one more speaker who would like to come up and say a few words. Mr. Hemu Klein from Germany, but are you American now, Hemu? Almost, lives in Laguna Beach. Please welcome Hemu.
Thank you very much. Yes, as one easily might hear, I'm German by birth, but I'm naturalized since 3 weeks. So my wife over here. So we have both nationalities. I would like to thank you, Chrissy, for having us being part of this celebration of Lou's life. I met Lou in 1973. He has been my eldest friend in the US. And today, you heard a lot of talking about love. Lou and me immediately fell in love. Lou, Chrissy, and me immediately fell in love. Lou, Chrissy, Gudrun, and as a family fell in love. And we didn't see each other weekly due to the distance, because most of the times we were in Germany or Europe. But two things I would like to mention. Today I heard a lot about Lou and Louis and all his names. One of the most famous names was Ludwig. And he used to call himself always Ludwig. And at the end, and you know there are a lot of famous kings called Ludwig, composer Ludwig van Beethoven. So unfortunately there is no famous singer except Ludwig. So always after we finished our talk, he ended and said, "Thank you, Hemu. I'm proud to be Ludwig der Große," which means Louis the Great. So, and he has been honored from all parts of America, I think, today, from Florida, California, Jersey, the old Idaho, McCall, yes. But the old word has been forgotten. Italy certainly is, Italy is universal. We were happy to have Chrissy and Lou visit us in Germany. And we gave a party to welcome them with our friends. And ever since, we go back, fly to the United States, which happened monthly, they're all saying, "Oh, if you see Lou, give him, say him hello." And they all ask him when he is coming back and sing a song. Sing a song. So it was very famous. When I celebrated my 60th birthday, we did this in Big Bear. We had a huge party, and Lou was there, certainly. And as always, unplanned at the end of the day or the beginning of the dawn, he started singing. And ever since, one of my 120 guests is talking about it. He's asking, "How is Lou, the singer, doing?" So I would like to say, all Europe is behind him, and everybody reminds Ludwig der Große. Thank you. Thank you all.
I am sorry. I guess I made a mistake. I didn't realize these vases belonged to someone. So I've just been told to rescind the, take the flowers, but we have to leave the vases. They aren't mine. All right. And again, thank you, everybody. Okay, and I wish he was here to sing My Way, because he's done it for several people at several celebrations of life. But I know he is looking at this, knows we're all here, and do a little something his way. Smile at everybody. All right, thank you.
Kenny Rosato. Yes. Yes. Nice to see you, Kenny.
Thank you. Hi, folks. I met Louis D. in 1972 in an Italian golf tournament, which I was running. And everything that was said today about Louis, I can echo. He was a one-of-a-kind guy. And I'm going to take a page, saying from a friend of mine who did a movie called Brian's Song. His name was Gale Sayers. And he said about Michael Piccolo, I loved Michael Piccolo. I loved Louis D. Louis and I would go way back, had a lot of fun together. He was like a brother to me, but we called each other cuz. And I could hear him in my head say to me, hey, cuz, on the phone when he'd answer the phone or I'd answer the phone. Louis D. was so talented, he could do so much, and he helped so many people. My son, who was the age of your grandkids, when he met Louis D., made the biggest compliment to Louis today when I spoke to him this morning before I left Las Vegas to come here. And he said to me, Dad, you have a lot of friends. You've made a lot of friends over your lifetime, but you never had a friend like Louis D. Louis D. was the best. He could relate to young kids, which he did with me when I was young and my brother. He said he could relate to everybody. He was friends with everybody. He lit up the room, and that's so true. And Louis, I love you, buddy. I miss you, but you'll always be remembered.
So true. Thank you, Kenny. Well, everybody, thank you so much again for coming. And please don't forget to take a hat and enjoy your afternoons. And a CD.
Now the children try to find it, and they can't believe.